Hi, everybody. We decided we needed to wake you all up because it's like Friday and it's been like a super long week. And I don't know about you, but there's been a lot of walking. So we're excited to talk with you about data ethics and privacy engineering. And I'm here with my wonderful colleagues. We've been working together on various different things in the privacy space for a very long time. So I thought maybe we could start by just introducing ourselves to you, tell you a little bit about who we are. And then I'll jump up here and do a little background on the topic, and we're going to go through a case study, get more into application specifically. But most importantly, we want you to engage with us, because it's Friday after all, and like we don't want you to fall asleep. Not that we'd let you fall asleep, but please don't hesitate to, like, we'll ask you stuff, you ask us stuff, all of that, no saving Q&A to the end. So with that, last of my colleague Lourdes, you want to introduce yourself?
Hi, everyone. I'm Lourdes Turrecha. I am the CEO of PIX. It's a privacy consulting firm where I advise startups on how to leverage privacy as a competitive advantage. I am formerly from Palo Alto Networks. I've also worked in privacy in big law firms and in Fortune 300 companies.
And I'm Hilary Wandall. I serve as the head of privacy intelligence. I'll try to tell you a little bit more about that in our talk today at a company called TrustArc. I'm also the general counsel there. I have been doing privacy for 23 years almost. So started in 1997 in a certain capacity that maybe will come out in this discussion today. But I served as chief privacy officer at Merck for 12 years, was there for a very, very, very long time. But today my focus is on really helping other people in our broader community understand the role of privacy within organizations, how it helps, if done effectively, to really maximize data utility, and that it really needs to be integrated with other aspects of data management, risk management, data security, et cetera. So privacy engineering, data ethics is a key part of all of that. We look forward to talking with you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Michelle Dennedy. I've been in privacy maybe a little bit less than Hilary, but not much. I was the first chief privacy officer at Sun, the first head of business development for security sales at Oracle, the first CPO at McAfee Intel, the first CPO at Cisco. The fact that there are so many firsts anything shows you how nascent this field is. I, along with my father and my business partner, Jonathan Fox, wrote a book called The Privacy Engineer's Manifesto. We've got a new one coming out as soon as we can get the clearances through my former employer called The Privacy Engineer's Companion. And it really touches on a lot of the things we're going to talk about today to apply what sounds like ushy-squishy things like ethics and reasonable and legally compliant and things that say they're certified. How many people have been asked for GDPR certified something? It's not a thing. So we're going to talk about some myths and some practicalities and do some karaoke if people don't interact with us. Mm-hmm. You've been warned.
Watch out. All right, so just a brief outline of our agenda. We just did our intros.
Oh, I forgot to say what I do now. I'm the CEO of DrumWave. We do privacy and analytics and cool. Lots of data beauty stuff.
Oh, look at
that. Data beauty.
So, we just did all the intros. I think we have a couple of benchmarking questions that Hilary would want to go over with you guys, just by raise of hands. How many here work for privacy tech companies like Hillary's?
Nobody in the audience. No privacy tech company. Oh,
very cool.
Two hands awesome.
Great.
Okay.
Cybersecurity companies? More. Okay.
Accounting firms?
Yeah. Five, six.
Strippers?
Seven.
I knew it.
How many of you are privacy engineers?
Okay. Be loud and proud, people.
How many of you are ethicists? None. I'm going to raise, one, yes, yay, okay. And I'll put my hand up for that. I'll share a little bit more. Okay, and how many of you are here just because you want to figure out how ethics and privacy engineering work together and what that really means? So just, awesome, okay, well, good. I mean, I think we hopefully can cover the needs of all.
The rest are here for the karaoke, right? Or this guy who's a stripper. We didn't know that. Good to know.
And we have some polls.
Yeah. Well, those
this
polls.
This is our polls.
Yep, those are our polls. And so with that,
stripper pole.
With that, Hilary, do you mind kicking us off with what we're even
talking about? Yeah, I thought maybe I'd stand up
even
a little bit.
Talking about?
Shake it up a little bit, maybe. We won't do karaoke yet. So what are we even talking about? So ethics. How many people feel like they know, before we even get to data ethics, how many of you feel like you really have a good grasp of what ethics are outside of like your own moral values? A few?
1, 2, 3, 4.
How many of you have had to deal with ethical issues on the job? That says a lot, actually. I think, you know, we all do. And what's been really interesting for me, and this is where I will bring a little bit of my history and background into it. So I started out working in privacy. I started actually out as a scientist in a pharmaceutical company. And I started getting into privacy when the New Jersey State Legislature back in 1997 introduced a genetic privacy, genetic testing law. And we had some folks who were working in government affairs at the time say, hey, does this affect what you're doing in the lab? And I'm like, oh, let me look. Actually, no, I don't think it does. But that brought me into a space that I hadn't really given a lot of consideration to as a bench scientist, and that is, what are all of these other considerations around the work that we do, whether it's scientific work, whether it's engineering work, whether it's uses of data, et cetera. So I ended up going to starting law school the following year, still working as a scientist, and then jumped in to do privacy in 1999 because there was this thing called HIPAA that was being, there was a law, but there was this regulation that was being proposed through many iterations at the time. And then there's this other thing you may have heard of called the Children's Online Privacy Protection Act, otherwise known as COPPA, for which it was enacted in 1998, but then there was some regulations in 1999. And we actually happened to have I had shifted to marketing. We had a website that we had created for children who were users of a product that we had called Singulair. It was for if they had asthma, you didn't actually have to use an inhaler, it was actually a pill. And because it was for kids, we wanted them to be able to create colorful images and send them in and have them posted online. And we're like, maybe we have to worry about COPPA, so we should really make sure that we have a privacy policy, because it wasn't a thing back then. You know, now everybody has privacy policies on the website here in California. We won't get into all those details, but it wasn't a thing. So we started looking at, like, what's the right thing to do? And that's where privacy, for me, in my first introduction to it, I wasn't a lawyer yet, I was studying law, but it was really about how do we do the right thing? And I was very fortunate, and I worked in a company that it was about putting patients first and really about ethics. And that became embedded into how we thought about privacy from the very beginning. And I will say, and I think my colleagues here will probably agree, that's not standard practice. But because it was for me, it's something that I've wanted to introduce to this field, and I'm so excited that people are talking more about it today. So fast forward a little bit to around, I would say it was about 2004, 2005, and it started to become obvious that genetic data in genetic data, sequences of genes, actually, if you had enough single nucleotide polymorphisms, you could identify an individual in a pool of DNA. And that created a lot of concerns because prior to that time, people thought, oh, I have a biological specimen, and I was a scientist in a lab. We had lots of biological specimens. If you ever read the book about Henrietta Lacks and HeLa cells, I actually worked with HeLa cells in the lab. I had no idea at that time you could purchase them and use them in the lab in cell culture to do lots of experiments. I had no idea there were all these things happening and how those cells actually came about. We all found out a number of years later. But we had thought and made assumptions incorrectly at the time that it was not possible to identify an individual from those cells, and so that really, or from the DNA, and so you really didn't have any obligations other than to use it in accordance with the license that you were granted when you acquired them. That everything changed after that, because we realized that it was possible to identify a person, and if it's possible to identify a person, we need to be a lot more careful, because as technology explodes, as the science explodes, there's a lot more things we need to worry about. So I was actually practicing law at that point in time and leading our privacy team, working very closely with our researchers, and we talked about the fact that the law wasn't always giving us the right direction. We didn't always know what the right thing was to do, and we couldn't allow the law to be the guidepost. So I went back to school again, and at that point I decided to study bioethics. And what was really helpful to me at that point was looking at how there's a place to help you deal with the gray. And that place that helps you deal with the gray is the values that actually guide doing the right thing. So what are they? What is data ethics? So I'm going to start with a couple of core things that I learned when I study bioethics. So the first is there's not one universal truth. I think we all know that, right? But there are different ways of thinking about things that help to guide you to the right answer, depending on the context and which you're working. And so for us, we learned that, first of all, you can think about it through the lens of not treating a person as an end in and of themselves. And that's where the whole concept of autonomy and respect for persons come from. And if you carry that over into the data ethics, it's making sure that you're not just using data in a way that ultimately ends up being a problem for the person. You didn't take into consideration their rights, this whole notion of consent. So we'll come back to that in our conversation. And one of the other things we learned is that if you don't necessarily look at it through that lens, which is kind of under the umbrella of something called deontology, there's this other school of thought called utilitarianism, where it's much more about balancing the good and the bad, the benefits and the harms. And that's something in studying biomedical ethics we learned was really at the core of a concept called beneficence that's very important to how doctors and healthcare professionals are trained to make decisions, as are researchers. So if you think about like human subjects research, those principles are embedded in there. But how does that become relevant to privacy and data ethics? It's really about looking, and this is what we're going to talk about in much more detail when we get into coding and design, is how, when you are deciding what you're going to do with data, whether it's through the design of an algorithm or it's just the uses of data throughout a particular technology that you're building, how do you look at the benefits you're going to create and who benefits from it? Is it you as a company? Is it society as a whole? Is it an individual that you're using the data about? Is there a benefit for them versus the risks to that person, the risks to the broader society? And so these are some of the core concepts without getting into a ton of extra detail that we used to start thinking about it. And it really helped me as we were looking in the grayer and grayer space to think about it first from the lens of values. And if you have the good fortune of being in a place to influence the thinking inside of your companies, one thing to start with is the law is always about a decade or so, if not more, behind. And so if you're looking to the law to guide you as to the right thing to do, you're going to end up getting tripped up. And this is how we see a lot of the decisions that come out from the Federal Trade Commission and otherwise, because people weren't thinking about the impact to individuals, that balancing of risk and harm, that not using an individual or looking at an individual as an end in and of themselves. So anyway, that's a little history from my perspective in thinking about ethics and how it then comes into data. But I want to look at my colleagues and ask them, how have you guys thought about ethics? Is it different? Like, what's been your background and experience?
So I think I don't have the formal study in a background in ethics, but what I realized is that the word for the day, I think, is what we ought to do. I think up until now, particularly in compute, we've been really hamstringed and sort of protected by the limitations of technology. Just because you can doesn't mean you should. So now we can have ubiquitous surveillance. That really wasn't possible even 15 years ago. I remember when we were all sitting together and working through what would then turn into, first was SB 1386, which is now the ubiquitous data reporting. Remember back in the day?
Oh, yes.
The initial draft from Steve Peace and Joe Simidian talked about ubiquitous encryption. And it was an absolute strict liability law that would say, if your data about people or anything that could be associated with a person is not encrypted end to end, this is 2000, we're having this conversation, then you have to pay these massive statutory fines. Totes adorbs. Who was around in 2000 in the encryption world? Was that possible? No. Ish. In very specific circumstances. And remember, not that many people were even convinced that they would have their whole businesses online in 2000. So to Hillary's point of the law always lags, even coming to the table, number one, with our perspective as technologists and saying to the lawmakers, I get your point, but really breach reporting should be about A, empowering the people whose identities have potentially been stolen so that they can take action, and B, holding people accountable who actually have a fiduciary obligation toward that data. It's not a technology standard. It's not about the technology. It's not about the business. It's not about the fine. At the end of the day, it's how ought we treat the human. And so now here we are, 2020, and we can see, we can tag almost anything. We can surveil almost anything. Was anyone surprised when Ed Snowden was able to pass on all this information? I mean, I love that the Snowden things were ever called a revelation. I mean, didn't anyone go to Black Hat other than us? We all knew this was going down, right? It wasn't a question of could we or would we or if we. It was a question of ought. I think the other point I want to leave you with is also is that I think when we start to dig into kind of Aristotle models of ethics, don't forget the East. So Eastern philosophy has a very different perspective of the person and personhood and personal autonomy. So if you put together, we're actually building systems for a global world, you have to take into account a collective perspective. It doesn't mean you judge it better or worse, but if you're putting a Western ethic into an Eastern culture and you're just dropping it in and expecting that the technology will somehow self-heal into that culture, you will fail. So figuring out what is the math involved and how does that actually shore up the what can we do, what are we doing, do we even know what we're doing and where our data is, and then marrying it to ought and who gets to decide what we ought to do. I think that's the trick, right? It's in, and it goes back to yin and yang, it goes back to the golden rule, it goes back to things that sound very foo-foo religious, but guess what, they work. A lot of these things, you don't have to be religious to understand that being nice to other people probably gets you more benefit than harm, right?
And I think the beauty of your points among all of them is that, remembering it's all about the people. Like all of this, it's about the people that are affected by it. It's about the people whose data are being used.
You know, when Wendy Naylor gave the keynote, did anyone see Wendy's keynote? It was so good, right? I think one of the most important things she said about democratizing security was we have been designing security in this field to be enforced and not adopted. When you're taking a person-centric view, you're actually selling more gear. You're getting more usability. You're testing it in ways that you wouldn't have if you only designed security to be enforced.
It's come up in the same way that it's come up for the both of you. In the absence of laws, privacy has, there's so much gray area, and we're lucky today that we have GDPR and CCPA and HIPAA and COPPA and all those acronyms in the privacy world. But it wasn't always that way, and even with these slew of laws, there's a whole wide spectrum of gray, and because of that, just because there is an absence of laws and rules about what to do and what not to do, doesn't mean that we should keep going, forging forward, doing whatever it is that we think we could. And so these questions come up with some of my clients who bring it up to me and say, just tell me whether GDPR, whether I can do this under GDPR, whether I can do this under CCPA, and if I can, I'm gonna do it. And that's when I start having that conversation with them about, well, okay, let's answer that question, but really, there is a different way of thinking about this, and that's where data ethics comes in. Just because you can doesn't mean you ought to do it, and that's how we see the wave of tech lash that we've seen, right? A bunch of big tech companies who have been operating that way for years, and now we've realized that just because there is this gray space doesn't necessarily mean that we can move fast and break things.
So that's, in summary, sort of how we've seen data ethics. Because we said we wanted to engage with you, I would just ask those of you in the audience, have any of you seen data ethics characterized in a different way that you would like to add to the conversation? Feel free, we have mics along the way.
Yes, I can feel you wanting to.
Definitely.
Please come up.
Well, one comment. I feel like law is really good at setting minimum standards, mm-hmm. but not enough, right? In my own organization, I've had an instance where someone has said, we're following the regulations, versus when I look at the process, it's like, I don't care about the regulation. Like, you can do better. That's the minimum you have to set at. And not to try and make you defend a position that you may not necessarily stand, but the idea of democratizing security is like, if they're being literal, anathema to me. I think a benevolent dictatorship is much better when it comes to security. Giving people a vote who don't necessarily know what they're doing in a field is maybe incredibly dangerous. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, so I mean, you're right. If you take the literal, you know, what is like the original Greek concept of democracy, I mean, who knows what democracy is right now? That's a whole cocktail conversation. But if you literally give everyone one vote, we have mathematics to know exactly what happens. You know what happens? You tend to the standard curve. So you're not acting out here as a Sigma rider. You're acting over here where everybody else is. You're lagging. So not everyone gets a vote. Not everyone has the perspective and the skill set to have a vote. So that doesn't mean that you don't design it for multiple end users, but you're absolutely right. I think you have to have controls and you have to have a framework that multiple people can understand. To your point about just because the regulation doesn't cover it, then I'm gonna go do. I recently had this conversation, a very frustrating one, and it was over a budget thing, as you do. And it was like, well, we can't hire any more privacy engineers because it's not required by the law. And then he went on to tell me at great length, I won't call it mansplaining, but he happened to be a man. And it went on, and where he explained to me that under GDPR, there was no privacy by design. And I was kind of like, that's when a woman whips out the madude, you know you're in trouble. Madude. Like, not only is there a privacy by design, but we were there writing it. We were there in 2010 in Jerusalem when the whole world of data commissioners agreed that we would do it. Mm-hmm. The fact that it's not codified around the world doesn't mean that you can't plan ahead and get this stuff designed in the right way so that your company is more sustainable. My counterpoint to some of this pushback of, oh, it's not legally required and so we don't have to do it yet is, guess what's not legally required at any company? Any guesses? What's not legally required? A sales team. Not legally required. You're probably gonna wanna have one. Or you become one. If you're the CEO of a small company, you're a sales team. So just because it's not legally required doesn't mean that that says you don't have it. The default is, how do I make this a sustainable company? Grace Hopper in 1965, let that sink in. 1965, that information would one day be on the corporate balance sheet because in many cases, it is more valuable than the hardware that processes it. And in her day, hardware was a room. Millions and millions of dollars. It was rare and powerful. And that lady knew where we are today. So think through that balance sheet that she's talking about. Why would information be on the balance sheet? Because it's a strategic asset. So don't wait for your lawyers. I'm a lawyer too. Don't wait for us to tell you you have to. Do it because it's the best thing for business.
So relative to, or do you want to come up and offer a comment too, please? We invite you.
Well, I was trying to get back to your earlier question mm-hmm. that you'd asked. And when we talk about end-to-end encryption, what always keeps coming up to me is the trolley exercise. Mm-hmm. How are we designing, how are we truly looking at our technology designs with that in mind? And I'm wondering if you guys have a lot more experience on this than I am, if you could speak to that a little bit from the ethics approach.
Yeah, so the trolley car exercise, if you don't know, who knows about the trolley car? Okay, there's some hands missing, so we'll cover. So basically, the trolley car exercise kind of starts out as there's one animal maybe over on this side of a tracks, and there's a person standing on this side of the track, and there's only one brake on the trolley, and the question is, which switch do you flip and who do you hit? Animal, person. these days, not sure how I'll answer. I'll save that for later over cocktails. Again, then you go further into the analogy and you say, okay, two people over here and four people over there. You're playing the numbers. Then you say, your child over here, 50,000 people over there, and you play the numbers. So when you're thinking about things like differential privacy or encryption standards, do you say we want to catch every child predator and therefore we're going to just expose everything to the world, which A, wouldn't work anyway, in order to catch the predator and thus compromise the private conversations and potentially even life-threatening conversations of political dissidents or people having marital problems or whatever. So that is how you model that. And the way I have handled that in the past, because I've always been in the depths of infrastructure companies, and now DrumWave talks to the C-suite. So I've been high and I've been low. And the way I do that is the same way that we do with software and figure out what we're going to develop first is you use user stories. You use use cases. You try some of the absurd scenarios, and then you try some of the uncomfortable ones, and then you get the kind of corner cases. And then you have to come to an agreement. And usually you don't have the luxury of having a full lecture on the trolley car, but you can do a user scenario and say, now if this was being examined by my child, by my grandmother, by a regulator, by my boss, what does that look like? And sometimes in the past, I've even mocked up a New York Times op-ed of this is what it would look like when we failed using your cockamamie idea. And sometimes when they see it mocked up with a logo on it that they care about, they're like, ooh, maybe not. So it's a really good exercise to continue to go through and think, try to think, you know, this is how Einstein did it, and he was a pretty smart guy. He used absolutely absurd examples to free his mind from the, oh, but we did it that way, and oh, we did, no one's ever taken a train ride to the moon. And that's, you know, that's how you really kind of say, what if it's a baby here and 50,000 people over there? Start with absurd and then narrow down and do those scenario testing.
One thing, I'll take this as a way to then bridge us into the privacy engineering conversation. I'm just mindful of the fact that we can't keep you all afternoon. So,
what? Even if we wanted to.
So one of the things, and we talked a little bit about the fact that the law doesn't say I have to, but one of the things that we know exists in some laws, not in all, not in the majority, but that is informative, is a concept of balancing the risks and benefits. Mm-hmm. And if you know anything about GDPR, you know that there is something in the law called a legitimate interest basis of processing data. Some people will say, poo-poo, oh no, you should always have consent from individuals. But this is something that actually helps us understand some of the case studies, the use cases, where it's, do I always have to get everybody's permission because is that the best way to manage the risks? Or do I look at the greatest good? So going back to the utilitarian concept, do I look at the greatest good for the greatest number of people? And is that the best way to balance the benefits and the risks? So a little bit of lesson in, if you don't know legitimate interests and consent and how those work, anybody like familiar with it at all? A little bit. Okay, so let me just tell you, and then we'll use this as a way to get into privacy engineering, because we're talking high-level concepts and principles, and probably what either you or the people you work with every day are like, all right, then how do I make that happen in practice? Yes, I can have these really good conversations, but when you're an engineer, starting with the use cases that you then turn into the user stories, that then turn into specific requirements, that then get coded, put into tickets that people code against and all of that, like, you need to be prescriptive. Like, what do I need to do? And so one of the ways we start with it is, yeah, if you're going to process data, which most of the laws around the world, not all, require that you have a legal basis in the law to process the data, processing being basically anything you can do with the data. And some of them say you basically need consent, or you don't have another option. I mean, they have a few, but we'll stay away. Like, some of them say it's just consent-based. What we found, and this came out of the European laws, is this notion of a legitimate interest of the organization or third party in processing the data that does not outweigh the interests of the individuals, okay? So how do you use that in practice? It's basically a benefits risk or risk benefits balancing test. Now, one of the things people will say is, I don't know how to do that. But actually, if you know anything about risk management and you know anything about looking at things from a quantifiable basis, you can, on the one side, list out all of the possible benefits to all of the possible people that could be benefited, whether it's the company processing the data, as I said earlier, whether it's society, whether it's third parties working for them, whether it's the people, whether it's people in the future, that's your benefit side. And then there's the risks. What are all the things that can go wrong? And if you come back to, like, the balancing is this whole concept of greatest good for greatest number of people, there is a way you can do that. Those of you who are mathematicians, there are ways you can do that in a quantifiable way. Not a lot of people have done it yet, but there are ways you can at least do it in a qualitative way. And that starts to help you inform decision-making around the kinds that Michelle was just talking about. Can we do this particular data analytics project? Can we design this particular technology in a way that's not going to cause more harm than it's going to benefit? So I thought I'd start there in just kind of introducing a concept that ties ethics together then to how do you start to assess what you do, and then once you get to that place, then how do you start to further mitigate the risk? If you decide, yes, I can proceed because the benefit's greater than the risk, doesn't mean there isn't still risk. So then you need to look at, here's the risk I'm dealing with, even though it is outweighed by benefits, and how am I going to effectively mitigate that risk through appropriate safeguards and controls that I build into whatever it is I'm doing with the data. So I turn to my colleagues, as that's kind of my ethics-based background. How do you take that to a privacy engineering space?
Excellent. Lourdes, you want to kick us off?
And I'm going to sit down now. I'm tired.
Absolutely. So that's a really good question. And where I start is I look at where the company is that I'm working with. Instead of reinventing the wheel, I look at, you know, what programs do they have in place? What is their software systems development lifecycle? And then I add into it a privacy decision framework as to how, you know, these existing engineers could start thinking about privacy controls and how they develop their systems and processes. I love this quote from one of my co-panelists and her co-authors that defines privacy engineering. And it's really taking engineering principles and using them to incorporate into your products and processes and systems the controls that you need to mitigate the risks that Hilary was talking about in a scenario where the benefits outweigh the risks and you're supposed to proceed. And here we are with this new discipline of privacy engineering that is new but very exciting. I don't know how many, there were three or four privacy engineers in the room earlier, right? And it's fascinating. I mean, I want to turn back to Mickey. How do you think about it? Where do you even start when you enter a company and there's nothing in place and you're tasked with the task of, let's introduce privacy engineering. They might have a privacy program, but there's not one privacy engineer. I've been in that position before.
Yep.
I look at what's in place, and instead of reinventing anything, I start working with the R&D team and their existing processes and incorporating privacy into that. But I would love to hear your take on how you tackle that big problem.
Yeah, I love what you're talking about because you kind of want to ride the zeitgeist, right?
Yeah.
You've got a lot of new concepts to introduce. So people, one of the ethical principles is safety. People like to feel safe. And so oftentimes you walk in with a whole new set of lexicography and foreign concepts, or maybe even the threat of legal retaliation or something, and people instantly are not safe. And so people are at their least creative when they're like that. So not to get too like woo-woo on you guys. But when I go into an organization that has a really strong policy front, first talk to your policy team and say, what are your goals and objectives and what has slowed you down? Why do you feel like privacy is not embedded throughout the organization? And sometimes it's a lack of funding, or they're just at the early stages of training, or they've had so much outside noise from a regulator that they really haven't minded the shop inside. And so the same as you would do for any other type of engineering thing, you look around, and I'm talking about old-timey engineering. I'm not talking about computer science or data. Engineers fix problems. How many of you took apart toasters and turntables as a kid? we like to break things. We like to fix things. We like to tinker with things. And so you've got that set of people that like to solve problems. And one of those guys is the Finneran on that is Tom Finneran, who's my dad. He started out as a computer architect and engineer in the 1950s for the US Navy. So he had a lot of access to computing very early on. And as I grew up and said I would never get into technology, and he and my mother are both intellectual property lawyers, I said I'd never go to law school.
You did all of it.
I did all those things. We would actually talk on the phone, and I would say to him, what works when you want to introduce new concepts? And so he would start with things like the Zachman framework. Does anyone here remember John Zachman and Zachman framework? Okay, homework assignment, yes. Start with business rules. John Zachman, who bless his heart is still around, he's like 89 years old, he came up with a way of saying, how do I convert business rules into IT, a technological service? And so he started with, what are the rules? And anything you ask a computer to do is a rule. So go to line 10, right? Repeat. That's a rule. Why is it there? What is it doing? I think we've lost the fine art of really understanding the precision in which we used to engineer systems, because tangible computing, it's so easy to grab globs of code and glue it together and it looks like it's functioning. So approach your privacy engineering projects and say, for example, we have decided to now put a pager on all of the children at these schools. I'll say a pager because there's darker things going on out there in the world today, whether it's on a phone or some other surveillance technology for children. Your instinct may be like, egad, pearl clutch, children, I can't follow them around, that's awful. Break it down and say, what are the goals here? Well, we've got an open campus near a cliff. Okay, what are the solutions here? There's technological ones, there's tracking. And then the question then becomes, okay, who's gonna watch the watchers? Who's gonna look at the tracking devices? And then there's the surveillance kind of overarching philosophy that says, well, it's a cliff and we have a physical intrusion problem and extrusion of children problem. Maybe we ought to build a fence. So you start, there's nothing that can be underdone about a scoping workshop. That's why our second book is all about the scoping workshop. Take the business rules and prospective outcomes and really beat them up. Sometimes that can only be a day. You have goals and deadlines. And sometimes it's much longer than that when you're really looking at a digital transformation. So you've got your rules and regulations. Now look across your policies and look at the verbs. We respect your right to privacy. Do we? Who's we? Who's going to be the one serving up this respect? How much respect? Is that in transparency? Is that in willing to have you be democratized? On and on. And you see, I'm using kind of the easiest example. Every statement that you say in your security and privacy policies is a business case that you are making, and a promise and an assertion you are making to a user. So the first thing you do is you make your privacy and your security policies shorter. Take out those things that are just expiration of breath.
Fluff.
The fluff, or the things that you're saying because you think your colleague is saying it. Those become your business rules. Now, I like to use universal modeling because that's kind of what I grew up with. But there's a number of different ways you can actually model big system and then down to what are the components that you're either going to buy, borrow, or understand that are going to come along with your employees over time. Whether you're in a waterfall, hybrid, or agile world, or DevSecOps, all of this will change and be disrupted. Don't let that stop you from a good scoping workshop that understands the trade-offs. Because I guarantee you, if you really look at your projects, and some of these are ongoing projects, you know, some of these are discrete, get something done, and others are, we need to update our identity portfolio. That's a very horizontal. But you have a universal set of principles that can start with the legal, that can start with the C-suite buy-in. You're going to get more budget. And then you can go in with these technical implementations. And then I guarantee you your metrics actually are shared metrics. And you're going to have a lot more buy-in when you get to the end of that project. So I know that's, it sounds like a bunch of management gobbledygook more than engineering gobbledygook. That's my number one complaint when people read the Privacy Engineers Manifesto is there's so much business involved. I guarantee you our technology would be better served if we thought about what we're building it for. So start with why you're building it and how you're building it, and then your agile scrum masters know what a defect is. It used to be that privacy bugs would be somewhere under 10,042 and below. They didn't seem like critical features. So make privacy promises that are going to cause harm to a user, cause harm to your brand, or cause usability to be defunct, to be on the top of your bug list. And that's how you start weaving these projects in, and you start to change the way people are talking within their own language and context to actually drive privacy engineering through the organization. I've scared out like three people while I was saying that.
I love that point that you made about using privacy interests to drive privacy engineering and the rules and driving it down to the tasks. And this brings us to our next point, which is how do we actually do this? You came up with you just walked us through how to do that from a privacy engineering perspective, but there are also other ways that we'd like to share with you from that has worked for us here up here and other CPOs in the field. And another one that came up from our discussions is using corporate values. And Hilary, you have been in multiple organizations, and you too, Michelle. How do you even start? Why do you think we start there in some instances and not dive directly into privacy engineering? Why do you think we're in that position where we're in a new company, we want to get into the discussions on data ethics and privacy engineering, but we find ourselves starting with corporate values?
So I would say in my experience it's because that's what more people relate to. I mean, most companies have some set of values that they espouse, and maybe it's a single value that they espouse. And everybody in the company, like if you've learned anything about the company culture or the HR team or the ethics team is out there like, these are our values, this is what we stand for. So everybody knows those. So if you start there, and people relate to that as being important and part of what they identify with and being in the company, and it's not just this privacy add-on. We used to talk about privacy by design. You know, privacy by design means you build it in, which means you need to go with what people identify with. If they identify with a set of values worded in a particular way and you're like, okay, you need to do these privacy things too, they're gonna be like, oh, I have to remember the privacy things. If you instead weave privacy into the things that they know and make it more part of that DNA of the organization, it's much easier for them to remember. So in my experience, that's the easiest way to do it is like stick with those values that already matter and tie privacy and privacy meaning and interpretation and application to those values, and people will remember it much better.
Yeah, that's a really good point that you're making. Michelle, when it comes to, you know, let's say you've had the values conversation, it hasn't worked, you've tried to make the case for privacy engineering, and you know, you're making some progress, but it's not the progress that you want. It's not the amount that you want for your budget.
That never happens, Lourdes.
Exactly.
People always listen to privacy.
Who here gets the budget that they want for privacy or security? Yeah, exactly. I've found more and more privacy and security pros having the conversation about societal impact, and I wonder, why do you think that is, and what is the importance of having that conversation?
I there's so many levels to that conversation. I think, as Hilary said, you start with the values, and what you realize sometimes with some of your customers and clients, and sometimes your very own hometown company, is the things that they say that they are, they say that because they're not that. Has that ever happened to anyone? We really care about diversity and inclusion. Sure you do. That's so sweet that there's only 4% of women on your board.
Right.
I think sometimes you have to understand that. And you have to understand, you know, we're all about open campus as long as everyone is being surveilled, right? So you have to understand, is there doublespeak involved? Is there a reason? Is there a historical reason they're making bold statements because they desire change, but it's not a part of the ethic or the fabric? I think when you look at things like democracy, surveillance, again, very Western types of ethics here, right? I think there's other cultures where being in very close confinement with tons and tons of people is normal and excited and acceptable. In others, it is absolutely banned. So you have to think about, first of all, where are you? What is the culture you want to inspire? And then also, I think for younger generations in particular, and I won't even call the millennials out, I think there's enough life left in us Xers, and kind of like I'm sub-boomer, but still claim X. And particularly, my oldest daughter is 18. She's a freshman, verging on communist now, as you do, right? She's 18. She told me about wheatgrass like it had just been invented. You've got a lot of these young people coming into your workplace now with a very different idea of what it means to be a part of an organization, how loudly they demand their voices to be heard, how they want to work, what they care about. And sometimes it's not money. Sometimes it is about inclusion and democracy and having a voice. So I think you have to design your program and your system, and you want to get as much of that energy as possible, understanding that it doesn't always come with, in my case, probably too much cynicism. I may go slower than I should because I've seen so much garbage in the past. And in the younger people, yes, I have seen wheatgrass, darling. I just don't like it. So judgment and age and maturity and finding ways to have a cross-generational policy, again, it sounds very foofy, but your technology will be adopted faster if you put it in the hands of someone who wants to have it.
Right. And I'll just add to her point, because it's, again, not to reemphasize, but actually to reemphasize, because it's all about the people. Mm-hmm. I mean, the data, it's all about the people. At the end of the day, how much data isn't about people? And if you solve for the interests of the different people involved, you get a lot farther. One other thing, if I can offer with respect to how do you really embed this into organizations, it just triggered for me, and I know we were thinking about talking about it, and that is the role of a review board. Yeah. So a review board within organizations is something I've had some involvement with, particularly coming from the healthcare background, where institutional review boards are a critical part of how research is designed. And what's really helpful and important there is you take people who represent the stakeholder group, the broader community, and have their voice at the table in deciding whether or not something is the right approach. Oftentimes, if you just have, for example, somebody internally review, like just a lawyer or just somebody who has more close alignment with the project, you're not getting the full scope of stakeholder perspectives, such that how you're using the data is being managed in a way that reflects the interests of all those individuals. So that review board concept, in my experience, has been very helpful, and I've seen it play over into technology companies now as well. What we did for some of the decisions, if I go back to the example I gave early on, we're deciding, what do we do with these secondary uses of data? Do we have a privacy concern? What's the best way? Do we get an additional consent? Can we use it without consent? How do we go about doing that? Is we had an internal group discussion with all the experts across different departments, and then we actually set up an external advisory board of experts from different countries, because we didn't just want one country's point of view, we wanted multi-countries' points of view, where we knew that they would disagree with each other, and that that would help inform the best decision making. And so this is a trend we're starting to see much more, where there's this ethics review that's done, and usually by a board or a committee, oftentimes with representatives outside of the organization itself, to make sure that, particularly where there's a significant risk involved or something really novel, that you're getting the best input that you can.
And just as a quick follow-up before Michelle kicks us through the hypothetical, what are some of the pitfalls that you would like to share?
The 0-minute cards been playing
with us in terms of setting up an ethics review board? And if we have time, we can do a quick hypo. If not, we can talk about it with you for those who are interested. Some of the pitfalls that you've found in setting up.
In setting it up. Well, first of all, it's the setting up process. Nobody likes a new process in the organization, right? You're going to slow things down. And so getting the buy-in across the organization that it's in the best interest of the overall business value, going back to what Michelle was emphasizing a lot, always have a business driver behind it. Why is this good for the business? Why is this actually going to help us realize more revenue, more value by doing it this way? And then put in place very efficient processes for making that happen so people don't feel like the process is slowing us down, we're not getting to market fast enough. So I would say those are the two core things.
Okay. Thank you.
Do we have time for the hypo?
She's like, no.
No.
So why don't we do this? This is a homework assignment.
Okay.
Get your phones out. We'll be calling each and every one of you next week for a review. I do think in
when
all
we do the karaoke.
Yeah, when we do our karaoke.
But at
I do
the bar
think,
later.
Do take this down and think through. I'm always sensitive at RSA, and you know, you don't need to put it in your review form that you think it's too soft skills. I hear you already. I think it's really important for you to come out as a technologist in your career and sit through these hypotheticals, particularly if they make you uncomfortable. So if you're sitting in your chair right now saying, I was here to learn about the latest privacy engineered tool set, and I want to know about the ethics engineering toolkit and the SDK for that, and you're a little disappointed because it sounds like stuff you think you already know, I want you to sit with this hypothetical and walk through it with teams, technical teams and legal teams, and you will be surprised by the array of answers. Even the words AI. Who here hates AI as a term? I'm not gonna lie, some Watson guy, is there anybody from Watson here? Some Watson guy was like, it really is intuitive. I'm like, okay, pattern matching. But we are using that term. I know, isn't that naughty of me? That's terrible. We love you, Watson researchers. I sort of want you to be intuitive. She's saying stop. I'm not stopping. but the point of this is, I think this is an important one because it starts at the very first line is, what are we even talking about? So sit down and figure out with people, what do we mean by AI? Mm-hmm. Because if you really mean intuitive, exactly. Person-free judgment, that takes this discussion down a whole different path. If what you really mean is we want to have predictive measures, some of them built into automated decision making, now we're in your hometown of technology. Mm-hmm. That's zero and one. What decision when? Yes, no, is it done? And then I'll finally, because she does have a stop sign and she does have the vest on and I do not, I'll tell you one of the best privacy rules proposed for the federal government last year, the very best one that I read and actually was cited by Cam Carey, was written by some young ladies down the road here from a private school, very bougie, so they're very well-to-do, Silicon Valley young ladies, but it's Castilea High School. A bunch of high school girls over the gap 6-week break wrote what they would like to see in a federal privacy law, and I tell you what, it was good. Mm-hmm. It was as good or better than the one written by Intel and the rest of the tech consortia. I'm in that consortia. So when you're designing your products, don't be afraid to use your kids. Mm-hmm. They're there to be your slaves. Mm-hmm. Test your AI morality on them. Get their ideas, go out into your community, check your church groups, go to your PTAs. They are going to be your ethics board going forward, and they're cheap and cheerful. You just have to buy them some cupcakes, and you're good to go.
And with that, thank you for indulging us.
Thank you, guys. And no singing.
No singing.
I'm a little